family came in through New England, and mine, from what I'm able to discern, came in through Georgia. So if we were related, it goes way back before this country. First Smith. Any other questions in the lunch?
Joseph Smith, to speak about Joseph Smith.
The topic that we're going to discuss this morning, very briefly, a lot of you already know about, has to do with the assassination of Joseph and Hyrum Smith. The assassination is occurring in Carthage, Illinois. It has long been the contention of many saints that have read and studied that they felt that the assassinations could not have occurred the way that we're told that they did occur. There's been a lot of feeling, a lot of information that Brigham Young was involved in conspiracy to have Joseph murdered, and there are other persons besides myself who have developed along that line. Personally, I ascribe to those theories myself, but there's always been the problem of proving something. You can say, well, I believe, but sometimes when you say that, belief is belief and it's good, but sometimes it's good to have a little bit more information that'll help you along that line of that belief, particularly when we're dealing with situations like this. Firstly, to give you some insight of how I got involved in this, many years ago I became involved in the shooting sports. Principally, I had been given a black powder pistol, a Civil War type 1858 Remington revolver like they used in Civil War. And I wanted to get, that was given to me as a Christmas present of all things, and I wanted to go out and shoot it, never had a place to go shoot. And one day I discovered that there was a place to go shoot, that our state taxes pay for, it's open to the public. And so it got me launched into getting involved in the shooting sports, and I just kind of went, graduated from step to step and thing to thing. I got involved in black powder, and it was during the process of time of getting involved in black powder and getting also involved in history, because you cannot, if you're into firearms, your firearms will tie, oh, have a villain collapse here. Your firearms will tie closely to your history, and it is possible to tell the history of the nation by representing firearms, which I've done before. The thing that I want to bring to your attention that's going to be important to this discussion is a thing that's known as muzzle energy. Muzzle energy is the energy that a bullet contains within itself as it is flying out the muzzle of the rifle or the musket pistol. And it's these energies, and what I know that these energies, these bullets can do when they strike objects, that then begin to lead to the idea that there's something fishy about this story here. I'm trying to
take your time.
Oh, take your time?
Yes.
Oh, good. Okay. Well, we'll do that then. Another part of the story I want to bring into it real quickly, and then we'll try to tie it together so I don't bore you all with tears. A friend of mine, a cousin of mine, had a theory some time ago that the murders could not have occurred the way they occurred. And his idea was the bullet angle. The angle of the bullet entering into the room could not have struck Hyrum where it did. Well, I didn't know that much about things at that time, but as we were talking, and as I began to recall in my mind information that I had concerning firearms and black powder, that's when it all began to gel, and I began to look with a new vision toward the story that we have concerning the murder of Prophet and his brother. Okay, what I want to do is just briefly explain a few things here that I've drawn. This is a basic layout of the jail, of Carthage Jail. This here is a perspective view of that I drew a number of years ago when I was trying to get this thing worked out. The perspective is not correct in the effect that this is shown as a stub wall, whereas that should be a railing. And then there's also a catwalk that goes across the area here, so it allows access to a window. You've got three windows in the front of the building, which is the doorway here that the mob entered through and up the stairway. The second thing is this window. This is the window that Richards claims that bullets flew through and hit the prophet and hit Hyrum and hit John and probably 4 dozen other people if he needed to use that in his story. But this is what he claimed that happened. The layout of the jail is basic. In fact, the front room is where they stayed. This is the vestibule. This is the stairway. And this door here leads back into the jail where the actual barred cells were kept. Now, some of you have been to Carthage and have seen this. And as I begin to put this together, you'll see how things could not have worked the way that Richards claimed that they worked. Part of the thing to remember is the steepness of that stairway, and the fact that that stairway is basically just 3 feet wide. My cousin took a trip to Carthage for me and measured that, because that was a crucial factor in trying to determine the matter as we get into the story. I'm going to start now with Times and Seasons, Volume 5. 598. This is going to be the August issue of Times and Seasons, and for those of you who do research in it, you also see that there's a gap and located for the missing version of the Times and Seasons that was should have been on the in circulation when Joseph and Hyrum were murdered. It's called 2 Minutes in Jail, and I'm going to take and read to you portions of what he says, and then we're going to take and try to examine this under the terms of what seems to be sensible. Possibly the following events occupied nearly 3 minutes, but I think only about 2, and have pinned them for the gratification of many friends. Carthage, June 27, 1844. I want to set the tone. It was a hot day. They had a light shower, and it was very humid. So it was a hot and humid day, and supposedly these events took place in the app somewhere around 5 o'clock. I say supposedly. We don't know for certain if that's true. A shower of musket balls was thrown up the stairway against the door of the prison in the second story. This would be the door of the prison. Followed by many rapid footsteps, while Generals Joseph and Hyrum Smith, Mr. Taylor, and myself, who were in the front chamber, closed the door of our room against the entry at the head of the stairs and placed ourselves against it, there being no lock on the door and no catch that was usable. The door is a common panel, and as soon as we heard the feet on the stairs at the head, a ball was sent through the door, which passed between us and showed that our enemies were desperados, that we must change our position. General Joseph Smith, Mr. Taylor, and myself sprang back to the front part of the room. That would be this part here. Front part of the room. They were against the door here. Against the front part of the room, and General Hyrum Smith retreated 2/3 across the chamber, directly in front of, facing the door. This is important. Hyrum retreated, according to this man's story, 2/3 of the distance, directly in front of and facing the door. Now, this is when things begin to fall apart, or begin to fall together, I should say, for me, in trying to figure out what could have happened. If there was a conspiracy, you know, and if this story is not true, let's try to figure out where it's not true and then go from there. So he says that Hyrum retreated 2/3 across the chamber, directly in front of and facing the door. A ball was sent through the door, which hit Hyrum on the side of the nose when he fell backward, extending at length without moving his feet. From the holes in his vest, the day was warm and no one had their coats on but myself, pantaloons, drawers, and shirt. Pantaloons was the term of the knowledge of that time. It appears evident that a ball must have been thrown from without. Now, he's vague on that. Through the window, which entered his back on the right side, and passing through, lodged against his watch, which was in his right vest pocket, completely pulverizing the crystalline face, tearing off the hands, and mashing the whole body of the watch at the same instant. At the same instant, the ball from the door entered his nose. As he struck the floor, he exclaimed emphatically, "I'm a dead man." Okay. He's 2/3 away across the room. He's directly in front of the door. We can see by the layout of the plan here, the door is pretty close to that wall. So he's going to be right here. He says the ball struck him in the back on the right side, crossed through his body, and struck his vest pocket on his right side. Now, the windows in the room, as a matter of fact, I think I've got a graphic here. I I'm sorry, I pulled these out on the on your last class. This is a picture, and this you're not going to be able to see it very well. It gives somewhat an indication of the windows. This is of the Carthage jail. We're talking about this window here as being the window in which Hyrum was supposedly struck with his ball on the right side. You notice that the window is not centered in the room. It's more toward the front part of the room. The reason for that being is the walls of the prison were so thick, and that when you added it up and made it symmetrical outside, it was not going to be symmetrical inside because the thickness of the walls took up a lot of space. But you notice that the window is not centered in that room. And so as a result, you have a situation where when you begin to try to examine this thing, how does a ball enter from outside, kick him in the back on the right side, and then travel through his body to the front with enough to pulverize his watch? Second thing to consider when I said, I don't know if I said, I said, maybe I didn't say that either. This is a second story room. Looking at this picture and then turning it up front ways when you see the front of the building, we're looking at a situation where the angle of the shot being fired, if the person was very near the building, is going to be something like this. All right, so what I'm being asked to believe is that the bullet fired, come up through the window, changed course, come straight line, well, changed course two ways. Come up, changed course, it flattened out, also changed this direction, then it changed course again, and then hit him in the back.
Another thing you might mention also is that that building had a very small courtyard outside of it, so they couldn't get very far away from it.
That's right. They couldn't get very building.
And as far around it.
Long-range shooting is concerned, that is also something that doesn't seem likely because we're talking about a situation where the we've got the Carthage graves involved on that matter, and they indicate there was no firing that came from their position as they were marching on the building. Now, I want to stop and digress just for a minute and take this into consideration. I just want to call this to your attention because this is a good reference book if you all want to research in this thing yourself. It's called The Carthage Conspiracy, The Trial of the Accused Assassins of Joseph Smith, Don H. Oakes and Melvin H. Smith. As I understand, this book was written, these men are Mormons. They went in and did a lot of research, and of the trial that was held, in which the conspirators of Joseph, that was supposedly murdered Joseph, were tried. And these men that were involved in the mob action, and they've got those of us who read the books by the pictures, unfortunately they don't have enough, but I was able to work through that. It was very difficult. I kept looking for pictures. And anyway, in any case, we have a problem with that. That's problem number one that bothered me, was how we got, you know, this 1844. I don't think they had radio-controlled bullets. I mean, we don't have those today. And so how that bullet did that is amazing. That stretches maybe one ricochet off the window level above, maybe. One. But that still doesn't explain the turn that would have to be made to the left in order to hit him in the back. And then tracing directly through his back with enough energy, because in ballistics, when a bullet hits or strikes something, a certain amount of its energy is given up. And that just goes right along with Newton's law. That can be worked into that. I'm not good enough on Newton's laws. There's a couple of teachers here, I think, can tell you more about that than I can. But in any case, in fact, I don't know if they could. I know they can tell you more than I do about that. The second issue to take that I took issue with has to do with Hyrum being struck in the side of the face and falling to the floor and exclaiming, "I'm a dead man." As he states here, at the same time that this ball comes through and hits him in the back, goes through and smashes his vest pocket watch, he's being struck from a ball that's fired from about, being struck in the face. The ball goes in through his face beside his nose, and we're talking, what are we talking about in distance here? 3, 5, 15. I come up with the less than 5 yards. 5 yards distance, of course, the ball went through the door. And so Hyrum takes his ball in the face and falls backwards and says, I'm a dead man. Well, you know, that's kind of a neat story when you consider it, because it would mean that this guy was in total control right to the very last breath he drew. Total control, totally capable, a man of God who was fierce in his faith. Unfortunately, I don't believe it. Not that I don't believe that Hyrum is not in total control. I don't believe it can happen that way, and this is why. I'm going to astound you with some facts that some of you may not know about. Did you know that there's rifles that will shoot through trees? There's rifles that will shoot through buildings? Give you a little information. In 1903, they developed a rifle to replace the existing rifle. I won't go into a great deal of detail because that can be boring to some of you. The rifle was called the 03, and it was being developed because we were having trouble with our people in the Philippines. Remember, there was the Spanish-American War, and there was the Philippine insurrection that occurred after that. There was the Boxer Rebellion we was involved in, and I could go into a lot of history there. When you get into firearms, that's what you get into is history. And there was a lot of things that were happening that the existing rifles were not getting the job done, and so they were constantly trying to find more powerful arms. In 1903, they came up with a rifle, a rifle cartridge. They developed the rifle. It was still not quite what they wanted. In 1906, they refined it. This became what we know today as the .06 round, the 30-06, because it was in 30 caliber, and it was invented in 1906. And back then, it was common to use ought as being the what you called a zero. That was an ought. So it's 30-06. Now, the 30-06 is a very powerful weapon. You take that cartridge and you fire that bullet, you're firing at something on the order of 2,600 feet per second muzzle velocity. That's not as important as it is the muzzle energy. 2,300 foot-pounds. A foot-pound is how much weight can be lifted in a foot in a second. That's more than what some of our cars weigh. To give you an idea of how powerful that is, at 100 yards, this rifle was designed to penetrate 5 feet of 1-inch pine boards stacked together. That means at 100 yards, that bullet was fired, it would penetrate 5 feet of lumber before it stopped. Now, I own one of these little babes. There's a lot of people do, and there's a lot of people who support deer round. Now, what we're talking about, bear in mind, is the military, what is called the hardball ammunition, the military round, which is designed to penetrate. Your hunting rounds today, your cartridge rounds, are designed to expand so they will not go quite that far, penetrate that far. But nonetheless, this is the point that we have to bear in mind. We're talking about incredible amounts of energy. I took and shot through a piece of plate steel at 50 yards, punched a hole right through it with my rifle. My brother-in-law and I was out target practicing on the farm that he has, and the two of us together, he was shooting a 308, which is like the .06, only it's a smaller cartridge. And I was shooting my old rifle, and we together killed a tree, which we didn't do that on purpose. We just kind of put the target board there, you know, and we were shooting at the tree, and poor thing. Well, we just punched holes all through it. Now, thing of it is, folks, and I want you to remember, that is mighty powerful. Most of you who live in frame houses, that'll shoot all the way through your house. As a matter of fact, for those of you who live in frame houses, that'll shoot all the way through your house, all the way through whoever's inside, all the way out the back side of the house. And this has been done. There's a lot of stories that have been told about the .06. There was a group of miners up in Virginia. The mining company was going to bring in a steam shovel that was going to knock a lot of guys out of the work. This steam shovel is made out of plate steel. This thing is huge, huge. In the shovel, you could put a pickup truck. So they put this thing on a rail car to bring it in, and then the men were trying to fight against the company to stop it from happening. So they took their .06 rifles and went out and they shot the steam shovel to pieces. By the time it reached its destination, it was worthless. It had a shot full of holes. Now, this is the kind of energy we're talking about. Now, there's a formula that is extant. And there's many formulas extant. Any of you who study into ballistics or into aviation or anything like that, the formulas are out there. You just got to know where to go for them, where the common person can sit down and say, okay, add two letters together and come up with a number and subtract this and divide it by something else, and here you got what you want to know. Now, for me, I get confused between here and there, but sometimes I manage to work it through. A fellow by the name of Sam Padala is a person that I worked with. I don't know him personally. He's considered one of the leading experts in black powder arms in this country. He gives a formula for figuring out your energy, your bullet energy of what you're doing when you fire a weapon. The formula involves your muzzle velocity, it involves the weight in grains of your ball, and it involves, then from there, by muzzle velocity, weight in grain, and by the amount of powder that you have, black powder you have set behind it, you can determine the approximate value of how much energy you're going to have. At the time of Joseph Smith, the common musket in existence was 69 caliber. The 1816 musket, which was a flintlock musket, was going to be most commonly found in the arsenals of the militia. And we're told the Carthage Greys were equipped with these. We read Richard's account. Richard talks about bayonets, muskets and bayonets. These muskets were equipped with spiked bayonets. All right, they were 69 caliber. By using the Sam Padala's formula, I am able to come up with a muzzle energy of 2,100 foot-pounds for a musket. Now, this is a smoothbore musket. It's not very accurate. Up to 25 yards, it'll shoot as accurately as a rifle. Beyond that, the pattern begins to scatter. Now, it gets involved. I can spend a lot of time telling you why. We don't have to go into that. Our point is we're talking between 2,300 for this odd-six that will shoot as hard as what I'm telling you about, 2,100 foot-pounds for the musket. Now, can you visualize in your mind what would happen to a man if he were hit by that? Bear in mind, we're talking about 69 caliber. You know, all know what caliber is? It's a decimal. They divide the inch into 100 equal parts, just like in the decimal, in the metric system, similar to that. On the metrics, they use their own. This is the inch. So what you have is a situation where half an inch would be 50 caliber. A quarter of an inch is 25 caliber. Three quarters of an inch is 75 caliber. 69 caliber, you're getting close to 3/4 inch. Secondly, remember, the balls that they used were made out of pure lead, and they would deform very quickly and very rapidly. They excised as they entered flesh. Okay? I am supposed to believe that Hyrum Smith took one of these in his face and had any brain left, or any head left, be able to say, I'm a dead man when he falls backwards. Plus, when you consider the carnage. Folks, I need to tell you that these weapons of that time period, any weapon is terrible. The weapons of that time period were horrible. I know a friend who hunts with a 58 caliber. He shoots the deer, knocks the deer clear off its feet, blows it over a ridge, tears a hole through its body that big with a 58 caliber musket. Muzzle-loading rifle. But Hyrum is hit with this thing, and he's able to say, I'm a dead man. Ooh, I don't believe it. Something's wrong here. Okay. The other point. Richard says that the building was fired on from the outside. The most powerful pistol, one of the most powerful pistols, not the most powerful pistol anymore. They have come up with ones that are more powerful than that. The 44 Remington Magnum, at one time, it's the handgun of the Dirty Harry movies, for those of you who may have seen those. It shoots at 940 foot-pounds. Standing behind an automobile, you'll be able to shoot through the trunk of the car, through the back seat, through the person sitting behind the steering wheel. The bullet goes through the front dash and still has enough energy left to break the engine block to stop the engine. My brother owned one of these. He got rid of it because the recoil was so terrible that it was messing up his wrist. I fired it with both hands on it, and it knocked me back trying to hold on to it. This is why I laughed at that one movie where they had the young boys going, well, anyway, that's another story. All right. 940 foot-pounds, he was shooting holes in stone. He was shooting in the quarry. And he was punching holes in stone with this. Now, Richards tells us that they were firing on this building from the outside. They were shooting with muskets. Muskets were not accurate. They were within straying balls flying. Where's the damage to the exterior of the building? I see none in that picture of it. Oh, I see none in these pictures that I have of it. The exterior of that building shows no damage at all. But yet we're told that these balls are coming from the outside. I don't buy it. All right, now, let's get into a few other of the issues concerning the matters that occurred. Joseph Smith was armed with a pistol. I have in my information, I took some notes of, I don't know if I'll be able to find it now, since I want to find it, I probably won't be able to find it. A fellow by the name of Wheelock, there was several men involved. I want to read this. It's out of the Atlantic Monthly of December of 1869. Joseph had in company the night before the murders, Willard Richards, John Taylor, a fellow by the name of John Fulmore, Stephen Markham, and Dan Jones. And they stayed with Hyrum and Joseph through the night. Joseph and Hyrum occupied the only bedstead, which was right there in the corner, while the others laid on mattresses strewn on the floor. That morning, a brother by the name of Wheelock came and visited Joseph. Now, Wheelock was involved in the Nauvoo Legion. He was a captain of the guards. He was a friend to Joseph. He was also a friend to John Taylor. Now, John Taylor and Wheelock were contemplating taking a journey through Illinois, and so John Taylor, who happened to be what they call an aficionado, a gun nut, a fellow who was into guns, he loaned to Brother Wheelock an Allen's patent. Revolver. Wheelock then, coming to Joseph, loaned to Joseph this same revolver. So this is how this revolver wound up in Joseph's hands. The brother by the name of Fulmore had given earlier to Joseph a single-shot pistol. Joseph then loaned or gave that pistol to Hyrum and took the six-shooter for himself. To explain this revolver so you understand, it's what has been called a pepper box. Now, there was a number of these kinds of pistols that existed in this day. It's just like a pistol without a barrel, but the real long cylinder on it. And each little, you know, what they did was they took barrels and they put them together, and the barrels were capped with what they call a cap. It had fulminate in it, and so when it was struck by the hammer, it would explode and set off the charge. Now, what happens is, this pistol had the advantage of other pistols of the day in the fact that it was known as a double action. You take the pistol, you pull the trigger, it revolves the barrels, the hammer falls, and bang. You pull the trigger again, bang, 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 as fast as you can pull the trigger, as long as the gun continues to operate properly. That is how the weapon operates. Okay? This is known as Allen's patent revolver. The militias of the day favored the 36 caliber model of the Allen's patent. 36 caliber was far more powerful than the pistol that Joseph received, because Joseph received what was known as a pocket pistol. The reason why it was called that was because it was small caliber and small size. It's 28 caliber. This caliber of pistol is hardly more powerful. Matter of fact, it is less powerful than our 22 caliber bullets that we have today, which are used for plinking and hunting rabbits and squirrel and things of that nature. That's how small the power is on it. But nonetheless, it's a small revolver. Okay, Joseph is armed with this pistol. Hyrum is armed with Fulmer's pistol. And this is where it gets interesting. You see, according to this book says, the Carthage Conspiracy, says that on that morning or on that afternoon when that mob fellow by the name of John Sharp. I showed you his picture. I don't know if I probably can't find it. Oh, there he is. Nope, he's gone. Disappearing Sharps, I tell you. That's a problem in music, isn't it? Okay. So, by the name of John Sharp, or Thomas Sharp, he is supposed to have been at the lead of this. Your thing clicked. And what he did was, he was carrying, I believe it was a shotgun or an old musket rifle. He lays it down on the ground and tells the boys that's following up, says, "Go to it, lads, they're unarmed." This is according to the testimony that's given in Carthage Conspiracy. According to that charge, they get partway up the stairway and they meet Joseph Smith Jr. Only the prophet is standing there with this pistol. Joseph fires on the attack. He fires three shots. Gets one of the men twice, the other guy gets hit once. Now, look how steep the stairway is. Bear in mind, it's only about 3 feet wide. I might fit up it. I know I can fit up it. But not too much distance, you know, 3 feet wide. We're talking about guys, it's almost single file going up this stairway. What would you do if you were going up a narrow stairway like that, that steep, and some guy meets you at the top with a pistol, and he's not just throwing it off, he's bang! I'll tell you what I would do. I'd panic. And that's precisely what happened. I already hit the three guys. They knew they had to be hit. And the two guys that he hit was the ones that was immediately in the front. Now what happens when you're on a narrow stairway, you're on a footing, you're not set, and you're coming up, and you're shot. Alright? What happened is, according to the testimony, Carthage raids began to approach. It was the testimony of those who were watching as they were approaching. They were approaching slowly because the commanders of the Carthage Greys knew that there was something supposed to happen. So that's why he was rank and filing them and making sure that they were all lined up and it would actually stop the procession if they was out of march or something like that. So these guys could do their dirty work. The testimony given from several of the cases in there was that this one man saw these guys flowing out of this jail very rapidly. And they were flowing out. I mean, after all, they said, "They're unarmed, lads, and here they go in, and they're being fired on." Well, I believe that there was more than just that. There was other gunfire coming from inside there. But I'll cover that in a minute. Joseph fires on these guys. Now, what? There apparently is evidence of the fact that this is true, because the people of Hancock County bought the two men that were wounded, bought them new suits of clothes for their involvement in the murder of the prophet. But in actuality, they didn't murder the prophet at all. They wasn't able to reach the prophet. The prophet was armed. He fired on them. Okay. Let's see if I can get this thing. Now, I get this point. I get excited. It's hard for me to pull all together. Willard Richards tells us that as Hyrum was struck, he fell to the floor, exclaiming emphatically, "I am a dead man." Joseph looks toward him and responded, "Oh, dear brother Hyrum." In opening the door 2 or 3 inches with his left hand, discharged one barrel of a six-shooter at random in the entry from whence the ball grazed Hyrum's breast and entered his throat. This is another wound on Hyrum that's important. Let me just kind of, I'm not too good an artiste here, but I'm a little stick man here. This is, I hope they forgive me, but okay. What he's saying is that while Joseph opens this door, pull the one barrel and shoot out at random, which means he didn't take aim, there's a ball that comes in, grazes Hyrum's chest. We're talking maybe about a foot off the floor, foot and a half. Goes into his throat while he's laying here. You see, he got struck in the back, gets hit in the head, falls backwards, says, "I'm a dead man," and then he gets hit with his ball. Okay? Because it's important. because I'm going to show you where I, well, I'll tell you now. I'm getting ahead of myself. Hold on a minute. Okay, if he once the ball grazed Hiram's breast and entered his throat, passed into his head, while other muskets were aimed at him and some balls hit him. Joseph continued snapping his revolver round the casing of the door into the space as before, three barrels of which misfired. He says three barrels of Joseph's gun misfired. He says he was snapping it around. This man does not say anything about any of those people being injured or being wounded. Although this book says there was two that was wounded. Okay? So what we have is a tremendous discrepancy. Thing that enters my mind, let's go back to Hiram. Man's laying on the floor. A ball comes through and grazes his breast, goes direct line into his throat, into his head. The fellow who fired would have had to have been lying on the floor. Remember, the testimony is that Hiram was directly in front of this door. I've got him draw it too big, because the room was 15 feet. This room is going to be 2, 4, 6, 8. About from here to here, how big that room was. So he's lying about midway there, a few thirds of the way over, 15 feet. He's lying here, and he's shot. The guy would have had to have been laying on the floor to have shot. Now there's another point. Richard says that they stuck the barrels of these muskets through the doorway. And as this door was being forced open, as they were forcing the door open, they were sticking these musket barrels through, and it's attached. I have in my possession this diagram that my cousin went up and measured that. 3 foot here, 3 foot 5 inches to here. A sum total of something on the order of 8 feet, 3 inches from this wall. The muskets of that period were, with the bayonet attached, would be just over 6 feet long. That means the guys would have to have been standing back here. But he says that they were forcing the door open with these muskets, pushing them through. Okay, another point. Musket's a single-shot weapon. You go boom, that's it. That's why the bayonet. The weapon that predated firearms was pike, the soldier's pike. And all it was a spear. And they had arranged themselves in squares. This is medieval Europe, and this is how they would defend themselves. Now, when you fired your musket and you discharged your charge, if you didn't have time to reload, that weapon became your pike, your spear. Now, bear in mind, to load this weapon, you fire it, you got to pull it up, put it down here. Some people are more adroit to it than that. Put your powder, you put your bolt. Now, that's if you're loading loose. Sometimes the militia would have cartridges in which the powder was poured in a pouch of paper, and the ball was tied to it, and all they had to do is rip it off, pour it in, and then pop the ball. You still had to ram it down. You're doing this in such little space, that there's no way in my mind that the men that would be able to do this would constitute a mob. Joseph was a pretty stout individual. He was a strong man. He was a laborer. He was involved in work. He worked hard. And he was a scrapper. When you read Joseph Smith and his progenitors, the book written by his mother, he talks about the time that he knocked one or two individuals off their feet while he was trying to maneuver himself to get away from a certain amount of a group that was pursuing him. Joseph was no slouch at all. He had some strength about him. And I cannot conceive of the man just standing there with his arms up in the air. He's standing in the fortress of a jail. And these guns are through the door. You just grab the barrel and pull the gun. Or you take the barrel and shove it back against the guy who's pushing it through. But Richards tells us that they were taking a stick and was trying to knock the barrels up with this stick. Second point, flintlock. Real quick representation. flintlock has a little hammer, it's got jaws on it with a little screw on it, and you put your flint in there, and when you pull the trigger, this hammer falls against a thing, a curved piece of metal that's hardened, that's known as a frizzen. The flint strikes the frizzen, it creates sparks, and at the same time knocks the frizzen back. You've got loose powder in there that it sets off. The powder, in turn, goes through a hole. The sparks go through a hole known as the flame hole. You've all heard the expression, fire in the hole? That's what this expression, where this expression and term comes from. It comes from black powder days when you had fire in the hole, because there's such a thing as what's known as a hang fire. That's where you pull, the sparks burn, and the powder is burning, but it doesn't go off. It's fun when you have one of those. You got to wait, because it's going to go boom, and you got to make sure that barrel's pointing the right direction, or you're going to be shooting something you didn't want to shoot. And so that's the term, fire in a hole. And so you'll find people in the black powder pubs, they'll yell that, fire in a hole, and then pull the trigger. All right, what happens is, this hole is directly in, it's right there at the powder charge. There's an extreme amount of sparks and smoke and a little bit of whoosh. Now, back to the room. They're discharging these weapons, as we're told. Discharging them. These guys are working with the 1816 musket. That was the common musket of that day. The percussion cap system was not prevalent yet. It was on the pistols. The Allen's patent revolver was part of the percussion cap. We had that little cap you put over what they call a nipple. You put it over that nipple, and the hammer hits it, and it's striking it. It causes that powder to explode. This thing is flintlock. And these guys are going to be standing like this with that flintlock pan right here with the muskets. I don't buy it. They'd be burned. In my powder, black powder club that I'm a member of, you're in serious trouble if you come up the firing line and you do not yell flintlock, because you're to give everyone enough warning so they can back off if you're shooting flintlocks, so you don't take a chance of being hit by these sparks, particularly getting it into your eye. All right. Hiram is grazed. He's hit. Joseph goes into the room. According to Richards, Joseph is struck by balls that come from without the window. Taylor leaps to the window and is struck by a ball, knocks him back into the room. Joseph then leaps to the window. You know, a real smart move for a brilliant man. Here you got all these soldiers coming on, and Richards tells us there's a bay around, and you're going to jump right out, you know, jump out of the pan into the fire. That's the thing to do. I mean, you might as well stay there and commit suicide if you wanted to do it. I guess Joseph was committing suicide. No, actually, he wants us to believe he was so panicked that he couldn't control himself. Hiram, in the process of having his head blown apart, could calmly say, I'm a dead man, but Joseph lost it in panic and jumped out the window onto the bayonets. What happened is we're told that John Taylor, who leaped for the window first, was struck by a musket ball that blew him back into the room. Now, I have a picture for you. Pass that around. That is a picture where we have John Taylor being knocked off his feet, knocked back into the room, being injured by this ball that has the energy to tear a stone apart. This man's little thin metal pocket watch is going to stop this ball and knock him back. I don't buy it. There's another thing I don't buy. You look at the face of that watch and look at the hole in the watch, and what does it look like? Does that look like 69 caliber or nearly 3/4 inch diameter hole to you? It doesn't. As a matter of fact, when you begin to measure that down, you'll find that it's much closer to 30 caliber. You measure it closer than that, you'll find it's less than 30 caliber. we're finding a pocket watch in a man who's got a 28 caliber hole. Now, Joseph Smith was armed with a 28 caliber pistol. What's John Taylor's pocket watch doing with a 28 caliber hole in it? Uh-oh. Uh-oh. This looks like a job for Perry Mason. You know, Perry Mason could always get these guys to confess. I think you can even get Richards in. I think Richards already confessed, though. I'm sorry. I can't explain that 28 caliber hole, folks. There's no way. I can't explain it. It doesn't make sense, because 28 caliber was the predominant caliber for that pocket pistol that period. The calibers for rifles went as low as 45 during that time. The old Kentucky rifles were 45 caliber. But that's not a 45 caliber hole in this man's watch, if this is indeed the watch. This then brings things to a head where we can see things and understand things a little bit better. Based upon this, I have come up with my theory of what happened, and I'm going to present it to you. And as I've told you before at the starting of this presentation, the whole purpose in this thing is to get you all to think. This is not necessarily the absolute truth of what happened. It is one theory that's plausible. But it's hopefully in the process of time, as research is done, we'll come to even greater truth and understanding. You know, we have hung people and executed people in this country on a thing called circumstantial evidence. And sometimes circumstantial evidence doesn't seem to be even as this. Let's take a look at this. Joseph is armed with a 28 caliber pistol. Hyrum is armed with what nothing is. I have not found any information yet to indicate the caliber of the pistol he was carrying, but I am certain that it had to be at least 44, because that was the normal caliber carried in what was termed a boot pistol of that time period. All right, that 44 caliber is pretty good size. All right, what we've got is a situation where this man is armed with a pistol, this man's armed with a pistol, and this comes to what I feel is a conspiracy. When someone is wanting to perform an act that's wrong, and then they're wanting you to believe the act is right, they have to account for certain evidences. In other words, Richards was going to have to account for why Hyrum was lying where he was lying, because shortly after the attack, there was a man who entered into the jail, and his testimony was that this is where Hyrum was lying, in this position. He's got to account for that. He's got to account for factors like in his story, blood on the wall. He's got to account for that, because that's an evidence that you just don't go in and get rid of real quick. The evidence of the holes in the bodies of Hyrum and Joseph. There was an autopsy performed. Here John Taylor supposedly is mortally wounded and lying in serious health. Joseph is dead. But where's Willard Richards, the doctor? He's with a dead man. He's with Joseph Smith when the body's being autopsied. He's not with Taylor. That left me think quite a lot on that, too. So here we have a situation where evidences are going to have to be, you've got to concoct a story, if you want to concoct a story, to account for certain evidences to explain it away. And so we take what he says here and take what is said here in the Carthage Conspiracy, and I come up with what I feel is a reasonable possibility of what happened. I believe what happened was that there was an intention on the part of the leadership of the church to destroy the prophet. Brigham Young had already been working long and hard, according to the book Origins and Revelation, written by F. Edward Butterworth. That's it, almost that. You had another man there. Butterworth's book is a very good work. And read through it, and you will find a lot of information that will give you insight into the things that were happening in the church in which Brigham Young was directly responsible. And this was the thing that was a shocker for me. I knew that there was something fishy about this story of the three original witnesses being disaffected from the church. Brigham Young apparently had involvement in that, according to the information that Brother Butterworth was able to bring forth. What happens is he states that Brigham Young had it in for Joseph long before that. Joseph, at the same time, was having difficulty in the church. He realized things were going bad. Joseph was constantly in hiding because the Missourians were sending bounty hunters to get him, to take him back from the state. So the end result was even though Joseph did make visible appearances in Nauvoo, he still had to be aware of where he was at, of the fact that these bounty hunters were trying to get him. And what this was over was the fact that there was an attempted assassination of the former governor Boggs, and Joseph was being blamed for that. Okay, that gives you some background without getting too much detail. Brigham and Joseph were coming at loggerheads. Joseph, according to one account given in Brother Butterworth's book, attended a conference not very long before all this happened, in which he and Brigham occupied the same rostrum. It is stated that it was a custom of the church at that time, if there was anything that had a problem, if anybody had a problem with somebody, that they felt they should be brought before the church and they should vote on whether or not they should be maintained in membership, that their name would be presented, and that there would be a time period in which they would be held. Time period in which they would be held before the vote was called. Okay, what happened was, is Brigham was presiding over this meeting, and he presented the name of the prophet Joseph Smith Jr., and instead of calling for the vote to sustain him in his position, he hesitated and waited. This got to Joe. Joseph knew what was going on, and he became quite angry. And as soon as Brigham sat down, called for the vote, and he was sustained as prophet of the church, Brigham sits down, Joseph stands up, and then proceeds to have his comment to say about Brigham, to which the important point was, is he pointed to Brigham and said that if the church was left to him, he would drive the church to hell. Brigham was a very ambitious man, extremely ambitious. There is extant works in church archives that's known as unpublished works. If you ever have opportunity to go to church archives, I've not been to it since I understand that they moved it into the spike. We can't call it a temple because it isn't. The archives did have a section in which there's a large number of unpublished works. A lot of people in our church getting their doctorates or getting their various degrees will publish their theses as they do research. I came across one having to do with Brigham Young and how he came to become involved in polygamy, having to deal with the Calvinites, which was a group in New York that Brigham ministered with, labored with, and worked with. And it was an excellent work. I mourn the fact that work has not been made available and was not published as a published work. But nonetheless, it wasn't. We have numbers of those in the archive. And it was, for a person who's doing research, it's a treasure to go there because there's a treasure of information. All right. Brigham was already in bad way with Joseph. Joseph was already upset with Brigham. He knew the situation that was going on. He then approached William Marks, who at that time was president of Nauvoo. Told William, this is 2 weeks before the murder, told William that he had to solve this thing. This polygamy was going to destroy the church. They had to stop it. He gave William Marks the power to go forward and to ferret out the ones who were responsible. Joseph claimed, as William states, that he knew who was responsible. Within 2 weeks, he was dead. Now, this is what I believe. I believe that Brigham entered into a conspiracy in which most of the people of the leading quorum was involved also, because they were also involved in polygamy. Brigham already had two wives. Joseph didn't know about the second wife. We only assume that Brigham had two wives. We don't know for sure ourselves. We know that there were several others that were involved that had more than one wife, who had married them secretly. Now, what's happened when you got the prophet of the church saying, hey, we're going to stop this business, and you're one of these guys that's done this, or one of these women that's allowed yourself to get involved in that? Ooh. Brigham was not about to be put out. He had worked too carefully and too long to engineer himself in a position where he was. The plot was to destroy Joseph and Hyrum. And I believe that they worked very diligently with the idea through the various peoples, the enemies of the county where they live. And I believe that the plan was that this mob was to go into the jail, seize Hyrum and Joseph, take them out, line them against the wall, and shoot them. I believe that was the plan. The plan failed. It began to fall apart miserably when John Fulmer gave to Joseph a barrel pistol. Then when Wheelock comes in there and gives Joseph this six barrel pistol, the Allen's Patent revolver, now we've got a problem. Remember I stated that John Sharp said to the men, as testimony in this book, as they came up to the prison, "Don't worry, lads, they're unarmed." How did he know they were unarmed? To say that. He knew, or he was led to believe, that they were going to be unarmed. He didn't know about Fulmer. He didn't know about Wheelock. Okay. Joseph has his 28 caliber pistol. These guys have got to move fast. At 1:30, according to the testimony that I have in this book, at 1:30, Willard Richards sends out for a bottle of whiskey. He claims he's a doctor, you see. He claims that he's having terrible stomach upset. Richards goes out in this area of the jail to receive the bottle from the guard. I believe it was at that point that he received more than a bottle. I believe that he received a 36 caliber Allen's patent revolver, the one that is known as the Dragoon model, that was favored by the officers of the militia. Favored by the officers of the militia. Oh man, that begins to fit. The Carthage Greys were the ones that were surrounding, and there was other militia there at that time. Okay, I believe that he then had the bottle of whiskey to settle his nerves, because he knew that he was the one, him and John were going to have to be the ones to get this ball rolling. They didn't know how this thing was going to play. The plan was that Joseph and Hyrum was to die by mob action. What's a mob? A faceless thing. Somebody comes in, paints their faces black, or how they did it. You got so many people, nobody can say, well, it was this person, it was that person, it was these persons. Nobody can say that. It's a mob. Okay? That was the way it had to go. The mob had to be the ones to kill them. But now we have an armed Joseph Smith, an armed prophet. And we all know that an armed prophet is a dangerous thing. Because we all know that Joseph is the type of man who will fight. He did knock guys off their feet when he's trying to get the plates from him, according to his mother. Okay, let's add 2 and 4 together and see if we come up with a reasonable equation. The crowd gathers around. Richards has got his pistol. He passes the pistol to John Taylor. John Taylor's the one who knows how to work that pistol. After all, he had an Allen's patent. He gave it to Wheelock. He's the pistol expert. I believe that what happened was the mob gathered as per plan. As per plan, the man lays down his gun. They're supposed to be unarmed. It's okay, lads. They're unarmed. They charge up the stairway. And guess what? Here's Joe with his pistol. Stands right here. Opens fire with the pistol on the charging desperados. And breaks the attack. All right. Richards and Taylor know that they've got to move quick. The mob is the one that's got to receive the blame for this. I believe that Taylor maneuvers himself in behind Hyrum Smith. All right, the first bullet wound. Through the back to the front. Straight line shot. A 36 caliber pistol has the power to penetrate a human body at close range. And I believe that that's precisely what happened, and I believe that Taylor was the first trigger man. He pulls in behind Hyrum with the pistol, pulls the hammer. Now folks, there's a system to keep in mind. The FF system, known in medicine. Fight or flight. Your adrenaline glands that sit on top of your kidneys pump a very powerful hormone into your system. That when your mind tells you you're in danger, you've either got to run or you've got to fight. And this hormone, known as adrenaline, will cause your body to maneuver blood into various parts. The digestion system, for instance, shuts down completely. Digestion stops. There's other things that stop. Blood, additional blood is then made available to the muscles, to the long bone muscles, and to the heart. It's been proven, it was proven in Korea, that it was possible for a man to have his heart and lungs shot out. He's clinically dead. From the standpoint of brain death, he's not. But physically, he's dead. To have his heart and lungs shot out and to continue to charge for 30 seconds, firing a rifle accurately enough to kill the one that attacked him. That was proven in Korea. All right, I mentioned that point because we've got to understand. Hyrum takes a very powerful hit. He's gone through at this angle. He's probably had collapse. His lungs probably got collapsed. He's probably had damage to major arteries within the liver area, because this ball goes all the way through him and smashes his pocket watch. But his fight and flight system was up. Why? Because they saw the mob coming. They were getting in position. They were going to have to fight. He had a pistol ready to go. His brother had a pistol ready to go. When Taylor shoots him, it doesn't kill him. When Taylor shoots him, Hyrum turns. He turns to grab the pistol because he now knows what's happening. While Joseph is firing on these, Taylor and Hyrum are in struggle. Why do I say that? Let's account for the second wound. Now, Richards gives us the second wound as being the ball by the nose. The second wound is the one that grazes here. If we cannot believe that he was shot from a musket from this angle, then how else did he get that kind of a wound? There's only one other way that I can think of, and that's if he is in a struggle with a man with a pistol at this range. The same pistol. Him and John Taylor are deadlocked. The pistol discharges, second shot, in through here, and that's when he falls. Now, how does John Taylor get this bullet hole in his watch? 28 caliber bullet hole. How does he get the other bullet holes? There's two other wounds in his leg. Plus, there's the third wound. I believe that Taylor's wound to the hip came from Hyrum's pistol. If it was a 44 caliber pistol, it'd be powerful enough to rip out a chunk the size of a hand. But not enough. From that, not enough to cause blood to spurt on the wall. Did you want to change that? Okay. I believe that this is what happened. When the charge goes off, it hits Hyrum. Joseph has already broken the attack. Joseph turns, and what does he see through the open door? He sees his brother in life and death struggle with this man. Joseph comes into the door and opens fire on John Taylor. This is how John Taylor gets the hole in his pocket watch. As Hyrum falls away to the floor, Joseph fires. He fires first at Taylor's legs because he doesn't want to hit his brother. As Hyrum slumps away with the ball having gone into his head, Taylor is now free. It's an open target. Three shots left in Joseph's pistol. Three wounds. One below the knee, one to his thigh, one through his pocket watch. Now, Taylor being under that attack, he doesn't know that Joseph has discharged all of his chambers. According to Richards, he rolls, falls to the floor, and rolls here. Of course, Richards says he was hit here, not back, and rolled under. I believe he rolled under the bed for safety because he thought Joseph was going to fire on him again. Taylor knows enough about firearms to know that 28 caliber is not too powerful. It's not going to cause him too much damage. If he can get his main vitals underneath that bed, he has a chance of living. I believe in the process of rolling, he drops his 36 caliber pistol. Joseph, being the loving brother that he is, would lean over his brother to see how his injuries are. Now, where's Richards in all this? I believe Richards is right here, watching the whole ordeal. And when it goes down the way it goes down, Joseph is leaning over his brother here. Richards picks up the pistol. Where did I come out? Right here. Comes behind Joseph and fires. Through the back. I believe it was a back shot. Because I think the man was cowardly enough, that's the only way he had guts to do it. Now, why do I believe that Richards was also involved in that sort of thing? Richards' own statement. Remember what I said, when you're trying to hide something, you've got to try to explain that which is obvious, that which other people know. One thing that Richards mentions in his last statement here was that he was thinking about jumping the window also. I'm going to read you this account. Joseph attempted as a last resort to leap the same window from whence Mr. Taylor fell when two balls pierced him from the door, and one entered his right breast from without, and he fell forward exclaiming, "O Lord, my God." As his feet went out the window, my head went in. Wait a minute. Joseph is standing in front of a window. Now this thing is about 2 feet, 2.5 feet thick wall. This window here, it looks like it would be up at least to the man's knee. Richardson's standing right behind him, two balls from the door piercing him in the back. And he falls out the window. How did it miss Richards? If Richards was standing right behind him, so that his feet went out the window, my head went in. The balls whistling all around. Whoa. The guard, according to this book, the guard says that as they approached, they saw Joseph come to the window. He already had blood on his pants. As he came to the window, he seemed as though to be moving slowly. His head first went out the window, then his right arm, then finally his right leg. Then he fell. Richard says, my head went in the window as Joseph leaped out. It's because Richard's face was right here where he was pushing the prophet out the window. I believe the man was the man that killed the prophet. And I believe then he realized he had to get Joseph out that window because the conspiracy was going to collapse if they could not at least get Joseph outside to prove that the mob was involved in it. And that, my friends, is where I believe the story went. As the story is related, he then takes John Taylor, pulls him back into the jail to hide him. And there is mention on part of several authors of that time period who wondered where Richards was in all this. Why is it that he was not wounded? We then hear this so-called tale about some prophecy being uttered that Richards was not going to have not even a hole in his robe. But you know, when you know and have become associated with people who are involved in manufacturing prophecy, these prophecies come from out of the woodwork just like that. And I have found no prophetic utterance anywhere that Joseph Smith had anything to do with about any hole in a robe. And what Richards was referring to was during this time period, they were getting into certain types of Masonic worship. And the Masons, for those of you who don't know, if they incorporate part of their worship, they incorporate a white apron to symbolize their purity. In this particular instance, although I'm not acquainted with the Masonic worship of that time period, they were becoming involved in wearing a one-piece garment that went underneath everything, called a robe. It was their union suit, I guess, is what it was. And so he was not supposed to have a hole in that, which is where the story goes. Now,
do you believe that Joseph was involved with masonry?
From my research and what I've done, I believe that Joseph, he was made a member of the Masons, not by his action, but they did it on an honorary basis. I think Joseph was under incredible amounts of pressure at that time. Not only was he having to try to support his family, but he is trying to find ways in which to address the difficulties that occurred in Missouri. He was very concerned about that, trying to get redress for the things that the people lost. And then, too, on top of that, he was having to hide from these bounty hunters that were after him. And I think that because of this, Joseph's guard was down. When they made him an honorary Mason, I think the records indicate that he only had DD. And they made him a 33rd degree Mason. And for all I know, Joseph could have condemned it. The fact of the matter is we do know that after Joseph was murdered, Brigham Young set Willard Richards to work in the church archive. Richards' main work was to go through the historical papers, and we have testimony that he was altering the history as it was recorded. We also know that the times and seasons was altered. There were many things in them that was altered also. And so there was a wholesale effort to try to completely change history, to implicate Joseph in everything that occurred. We have a man who came to the restoration, to the reorganization during the 1870s, who first joined the Mormon Church. And part of the reason why he quit the Mormon Church was he went to work in the church archive, and they were still, even at that late date, they were still involved in the process of trying to alter history, alter the record. Now, this story, you'll find in the book, They Made a Difference, written by Roy Chevelle. And I can't remember the name of the brother who was that brother, but that's where you'll find the reference to it. Okay, one other thing I wanted to mention. You know that picture you passed around? This is the same picture. Well, not the same picture. What's different about those two pictures? No?
The time on the watch.
The time on the watch.
Yes.
This watch doesn't have any hands. This watch does.
The hole's off.
The hole is off too because the base is twisted. You see, when that ball struck that watch, it destroyed the watch. The watch absorbed the impact. And you'll see the cracks along the surface. The balance wheel and all that was hit. That's, I mean, it poked it up to the... Yeah, those hands are gone on. I don't know why there seems to be a significant at that time. This book was published by the Mormons. I picked it up years and years and years and years ago at the Liberty Jail. And when I visited up there, and it's called Truth Restored, A Short History of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, by Gordon and Hinckley. This picture I took out of the LDS church history.
Not 5 o'clock either.
No, it's not 5 o'clock. Yes?
Isn't there blood on the floorboards of the jail? Isn't there like blood?
Well, the people at Carthage Jail claimed that was blood. Most of the individuals that I've known who have seen that said that it didn't look like blood to them. Blood usually, over a period of time, will darken extremely. It becomes extremely dark. And when it dries up, it deteriorates. It's biological tissue matter.
Besides that, don't you think they washed the floor?
I would think they washed the floor.
That's ridiculous.
Right, because this building was used for that for quite some time. As I understand, it even became a private residence for a period of time. For the Mormons Party, I guess.
I always wonder why you would have jumped out of that window anyway, because that's no small jump, and if you're wounded, I can't see any advantage to it.
Right. Plus the fact that all these bayonets around here, these soldiers, he was in a fortress. There was no ball that was going to be able to get through this wall. This is the thing that is so incredible about him. Consider that they could have positioned themselves in any corner. And here again, Joseph, according to the testimony, went to the top of the stairs and fired down on his attackers. He had broken that attack, so they were secure. There was no reason for him to jump out the window at all. But to believe the story that he jumped out the window because of this fire, we have to believe that he had attackers on the landing and that they were able to push through this door and open fire. And when you consider the dimensions of the room, even that, this seems unlikely because of the fact that all it would take is one shot from a musket to finish the man off. You know, during the Civil War, I have a book at home on the Mexican-American War. This was the war that our country fought 15 years before the Civil War. And those men who come out of that war, a lot of them who were wounded, they were torn to pieces. Their arms were gone, legs were gone, political cartoons. It was our first... Some people claim that the Mexican-American War was our first Vietnam. It was eventually called Polk's War. Of course, President Polk was involved in it. He was the one in charge of it. I believe it was a necessary war because if it weren't for that war, our nation would not have the boundaries that it has now. But nonetheless, the carnage from that weaponry, there's no way that Joseph could have received those kinds of fire without it tearing him apart. His wounds had to come from a pistol, not a musket.
How did Hyrum get the bullet in the face? Did he?
This is another assertion. I believe that Richards went back and shot him.
Shot him, yeah.
To finish him off, make sure that he was dead. To me, that's the only thing that makes sense. Here again, we're talking in a situation that I don't know. I would have to do some more research on my ballistics. If Hyrum was laying on the floor and he shot him, then it would be sensible that the back of the skull would not be penetrated because the floor would absorb the impact. So the ball would not have gone through.
It wasn't a bullet that would have gone through Joseph when he got shot?
Yeah, I believe that Joseph's fired from the back seat. He had two wounds in the front, two wounds in the back.
Did it go all the way through?
I believe it did.
No,
I don't believe that because the reason why I don't believe that is because the angles which being fired, if you look at it, the ball went to Hyrum's nose. Now, here again, I'm dealing with information that I don't have a great deal of information on, and one of these days I'm going to get that up. Brother Fry presented me with some information this morning that's going to be quite helpful as we continue this, because this thing is still, a lot of this is theory. But let me say this about that, and we'll go on. I really feel that he fired at him in such a way where the balls would have missed the Hyrum's body. and should have lodged either in the floor or in the wall. You see, he talks about blood on the wall, and that's another thing I forgot to mention. I believe the reason why the blood on the wall is significant is because when you shoot through a human body, and it's kind of gory to talk about, but when you shoot through a human body, you've got a column of pressure on your blood. And usually what happens is there's a spurt of blood, a geyser of blood that comes from that wound. And depending upon the person, here we're talking about an individual whose heart is pounding, he's now seen his brother, and that his pressure had to be incredible. And so this would explain to me why there was blood on the wall. He shoots through him, the blood goes on the wall, the splatters the wall. And so this to me makes more sense than it coming from Taylor's hip. Because Taylor's pants would have contained a lot of it, as far as I'm concerned. I really feel that the wound to Hyrum's head was inflicted by Richards after, or either before he threw Joseph out or after. I think after he got Joseph out of there, that's what he did.
Do you want to mention anything about the absence or presence of Brigham in that area?
Okay. The story is that we have from the history is that Brigham supposedly was in Boston. But there were several eyewitness accounts of individuals that have made information known. A lot of it's not included in our church history. It come from other sources because these were individuals who had families that told them, and then it came to our latter-day knowledge that Brigham was seen in Nauvoo the day that Joseph was murdered. And in one instance, I believe it was the individual that saw Brigham, Brigham recognized that the man recognized him. He turned back and told the man that he had better forget it if he knew what was good for him. So there's indications, there's other indications that slip my mind right now. There's other indications that Brigham was in Nauvoo at the time that this incident occurred.
Also, there's implicated in the Hodge murders.
Oh, absolutely not. When you get into I'll put the cap on it. When you get into the situation of Brigham Young, you're going to discover that this man was far more morally corrupt than what I had even considered. Winter Quarter and the work that Brother Butterworth does, giving that information. If that doesn't convince you that Brigham had to be off the beam, you know, a guy just doesn't go off the track just right like that. I know it can happen. I don't believe it. Brigham Young makes a statement. And this statement is let me find it. The statement, I found it in the book that was in our church archive. It should be available in other libraries, called Holy Murder. The story of Porter Rockwell is written by Kelly and Bernie. This statement is supposedly made by Brigham Young at the site of Salt Lake in 1856, on November 6, 1856. This is Brigham Young's statement. I have many a time on this stand dared the world to produce as mean devils as we can. We can beat them at anything. We have the greatest and the smoothest liars in the world, the cunningest and most adroit thieves, and every other shade of character you can mention. We can pick out elders in Israel right here who can beat the world at gambling, who can handle the cards cut and shuffled with the smartest rogue on the face of God's footstool. I can produce elders here who can shave the smartest shavers and take their money from them. We can beat the world at any game. We can beat them because we have men here that live in the light of the Lord, that have the holy priesthood, and hold the keys of the kingdom of God. 1856. That's not too terribly long after all this occurred. The smoothest liars? I tell you what, I think it's not smooth, but close to smooth land over there.
You might also point out the research that Wayne Verniel Simmons have done about where Brigham was supposed to be during that time.
Oh, yes.
Now, he was supposed to have been in Boston campaigning for a prophet of the Lord to be the president of the United States. And so here's an apostle campaigning for a prophet to be the president. If that's not newsworthy, I don't know what is. And they have looked through newspapers out there to find any physical evidence that he was ever in Boston at that time. There is none. No newspaper articles or anything. Besides the fact now we have some eyewitnesses who believe that they've seen him in Nauvoo that day, and so he's very much implicated in this plot.
Oh, absolutely. And I think when we get down to it, we're going to find that that Brigham. Well, I believe that it's going to be proved the conspiracy. Now, folks, on the information that I give you today, just for recap, what you've done here is a lot is theory, but I think that we can prove nothing else. I think that we can prove that the story that comes to us out of our times and seasons is an absolute fabrication. It did not happen. It could not happen the way they said it did. That within itself should lead our mind to that why does a church organ need to tell a lie?
Did you discuss the Nauvoo neighbor in this class? I don't think you did.
No, I forgot to mention the fact of the Nauvoo neighbor, that when the bodies of Hyrum and Joseph were brought back in Carthage, they were laid in state in the mansion house. Now, you see, here's another thing where there could not be a whole lot of cover-up as far as the wounds. At least as far as Hiram's wounds were concerned, they should have been obvious to those who came by and viewed the casket. So, see, he's got to account for this. But what happened was there was a viewing stand, stand erected across from the mansion house. And this is in Joseph Smith III's testimony in his works where I got this information. Willard Richards sat on this stand, and he then gave a rendition of what happened in Carthage. Now, this is right after men are murdered. They're lying in the house. The Nauvoo neighbor reported the story, and this neighbor is edited by the council, that is the High Council of Church, reported the story that Joseph and Hyrum fell to their knees and they lifted up their hands and gave the Masonic shout as they were being murdered. The story then changes by the same people who are in charge of editing the times and seasons to the present story. Now, I found another story in here, a mention of it, that was also, I don't have that mark where I can review it for you, but it mentions that there's a contradiction to that which is given in this particular account of the August issue in the times and seasons. So you see, there was a time in which it seemed like the church leadership was having difficulty getting their stories together, trying to get their story solidified, something that sounded plausible. Yes.
Is the times and seasons the same when it's in the church history volumes, the official church history volumes, the organized church?
Yeah. As far as I know, it is, yes.
And so it's exactly the same one that the church has accepted as true.
Right. You see, immediately after this occurred, Brigham began work to try to alter history. He knew he had to do that because he had to implicate the prophet Joseph Smith in everything he was wanting to do. He elevated Joseph above that of just simple prophet. He almost elevated him to godlike status. And the reason why he did that was because you get people to that kind of point, then all you got to do is say, well, Joseph did this. Then you've got your justification. And that's the way he did. He was a very shrewd man, very shrewd. As some individuals stated, he was not that shrewd. The devil's just more shrewd than what we give him credit for. And so what happened was he was able to beguile vast numbers of people, and they followed after him. The things that occurred at Winter Quarter should have been a clear signal to all those who were not certain which side of the fence they should have been on. But unfortunately, the same thing that happens there is what's happening today in our church. You have people who get locked into the idea that the church and the structure is what we are to follow and worship, and that's not it. We're supposed to follow our Lord Jesus Christ, His doctrine, His life. And if the church, we remember that the church is His tool, but there is no guarantee that that church is not going to make error. And we as a people have a responsibility to stand knowledgeable so we can stop these errors when they occur. And what happened was is that the people behind Brigham Young at that time were not that strong in their faith and were not that strong in the Scripture. They were unable to stop it. And they didn't care to stop it because they wanted to believe that the church was right and that the Lord was not going to let the church go wrong. And so when Brigham took over, they followed him. They rode on the coattails of Brigham Young.
Do you have anything you'd like to say about the inquest that Governor Ford made about these murders? Was there any contradiction or any reason that was cover-up?
I believe that Governor Ford was sincere. And I do not believe that Governor Ford was involved in the conspiracy. I think that Ford was working on information that had been given him and that certain guarantees that had been given him by people that were working around the situation. I believe the conspiracy was wholly contained within, there was the Masonic Lodge there at Nauvoo, but I believe that the Masonic Lodge was not totally involved. I believe that only portions of them were. And they were involved in the sense of the word, they were to get Joseph out of that jail. As far as the governor being involved in that conspiracy, I am inclined at this point to believe that Governor Ford was not, that he was a man that was caught in the middle, that when he took the troops to march to Nauvoo, that he was doing so under good faith, that his guards there at Carthage were going to handle the situation, and that Joseph would be.
What kind of a jail setup was it where you could get the guns to the prisoners?
Well, it was a situation where Joseph was not under total full arrest. Out of respect to him, originally when he went to Carthage, he and Hyrum were allowed to stay in a hotel. But one of the conspirators complained to a judge, and it was the action of a judge that got him placed into the jail. But even at that, he was occupying the quarters that was held by the jailer. So he was not under a total arrest where he was back in the cells. It was more like an arrest for protection, like a protected custody. And so as a result, as captains of the guards came in, he not being charged with any crime, it would therefore not be out of character for this time period of our nation for them to have taken the pistol in openly and given it to him. Now the jailers that were involved, they may have known, they may not have known. I'm inclined to didn't know, because I feel that had they known, they would have got the information out more so than what they did. But as it stands, that would be in character for the time period of our nation. Any further questions? Or
thank you very much.
I think that's a wrap.
Okay. Let's thank him with a round of applause. There you go. Go ahead.
Okay. Many years ago, when I became involved in the Lord's work in this church, I was probably closer to the Lord at that time than what I feel I am now, and that would be in character of how the Lord sometimes does things. He pulls us in, and then he lets us grow, and continues with us as we carry. I had a number of wonderful spiritual things that happened to me, and one of those things was I was given a dream. It was an odd dream in the fact that the way it started, I saw a building, and I looked down upon this building and became aware that there were people in this building and they were doing things that was vile to God. And the scene changed to where I was on the outside of this building and I'm seeing these palm trees, and it's at a certain time of night, and it was very beautiful, and it was one of those dreams where I could even feel the weather. The weather was beautiful. Yet it was odd in the fact that I was up, elevated where I could see. The next scene changed to this large building, and this building was incredible. I'll just kind of do a little, I don't know if I can sketch it out here, because my memory's kind of stale on some of it. The building had a spire that went up like so, and there was a point up here at the top, and then it had wings out like this. And it looked like, I don't know how to say it, but it looked like there was a wing that came through the front this way and one that come this way like this. And then there was lattice work in here, and there stone or masonry of some sort, and then there were stones that had designs in them that went down this thing like that. And it was kind of like that. And the next scene that I remembered seeing was this. And I saw this scene, and I became aware that off to this side, I'm overlooking a bay, or it looks like a body of water. And it was very beautiful, and it was right at twilight. It's where, on one part of the sky, when the sun goes down, you still got this haze of blue out west. It's real dim blue, and you start to see some of it over in the east, it's black. And there's some clouds, and I became aware the presence of the Lord. It was up there. Now, I'm not going to say anything about that particular instance, other than the fact that there was a command that was given. And I saw this building explode. And I mean it exploded with complete force. It completely demolished it. Well, this little piece here with this thing like a stone arched over. And as I was standing here viewing it, I was removed backward maybe about 10 feet, just like that. I mean, just like you blink your eye and I was back about 10 feet. And this stone landed with a thud and hit right in front of me where I was standing. It wasn't where precisely where I was standing. If I'd been left standing there, it wouldn't have hit me anyway, but I was still moved back. And that was the end of the dream. Seeing this building destroyed, this incredible, it was just totally destroyed. And this storm come my way. Well, the thing obvious to me about her, when I woke up, it was so real. I never forgot it. So I put it back here, you know, because I never understood the meaning of it. Well, one day, remember this book when I went out and got these books at Liberty Jail? This was a part of a handful of stuff I grabbed. And this was about a year after I saw this. I got up real early in the morning, picked up some of their literature, and I went out on the porch. And I was up before all the rest of the family was, and I opened this thing up, and I'm looking at this. I flipped one more page over, and I'm like this. There was my building, the building with the spire. It's the Mormon Temple in Los Angeles. And when I saw that, I then flipped the other page, and I saw the other building, and it was also a Mormon temple. I think it was in San Diego. I'd never seen those buildings before in my life. And the thing of it was, is I saw this building at the precise of what this picture was taken on this brochure. And that's when it came to me, the understanding that the Mormon church is going to be destroyed. That stone coming my way was an indication of a certain portion of that church that's going to come to the truth. But the rest of it is going to be scattered. It's going to just fall apart. I have held that conviction since that time, and I have not changed it. I feel even stronger toward it, particularly as this stuff began to come to surface. What we're dealing with here, folks, is information that if we find enough factual information behind it, it will destroy the Mormon church. Because you destroy the underpinning. If you can prove to the Mormon people that their Brigham was involved in the murder of the prophet, then you have undermined and tore away all that their faith is based on and concerning the Adam God worship, and concerning polygamy, concerning the spiritual wife system, concerning blood atonement, all those things. And bear in mind, they did not change their doctrine on blood atonement. They merely, as a matter of pressure from the United States government, you know.
Formality.
Right. Formality changed it. And if there's ever a collapse in the American government, ever, they will go back to that system and we will mourn. But I believe at that time, before that time occurs, that they will be destroyed. That's my testimony, and I...
You haven't said anything about the missing issue of the times and seasons.
Okay. The missing issue of the times and seasons, as you go through there, you'll find that there was an issue. Times and seasons came out the first of the month and then at the 15th. Now, I was in publishing myself for a period of time, and what you do is you put the date on the cover of your work, when it's going to come forward, when it's going to hit the stand, when it's going to be available to the people. And the times and seasons was dated. Joseph and Hyrum was murdered on the 27th. So that means that there was an issue that should have been out for over a week. It's gone. It's not in here because you come through it and you find that it's missing. And what happens is they explain it by saying, well, there was a lot of pressure and a lot of things. Well, that's not true. I have information that's been presented to me. Brother Fry presented a part of what he knew of it, and it was the same information that I received from another source that indicated that... what was his name?
Wayne Simmons?
Yeah, Simmons, I think it was.
Wayne and Vernal Simmons, right.
Right. He was on up in Chicago.
Oh, excuse me. Wayne told me that story. It was quite the thing.
That's what we know.
Okay, I probably have that here.
Troyer was his last name.
Yes, Troyer. That's right.
Luther Troyer's brother. I can't think of his last first name.
Okay. He was up in Chicago and was doing some research work when he came across in this great huge library up there when he came across that missing copy of the Times and Seasons. In that copy of the Times and Seasons, he noticed that there was information in which Joseph Smith apparently was had placed an article in which he was fervently making statements against polygamy, and I believe also mentioned Brigham Young by name.
Raymond Troyer.
Raymond Troyer.
No, it did not name Brigham. There was two articles in that edition of Times and Seasons. On the left hand, Joseph had an article where he stated that there were men in the church and the high councils that were going to be brought to trial
right,
for transgression of church with about marriage. On the right-hand column was an article written by Hyrum stating the church law about marriage.
Okay, all right, that's what it was. Okay, and so the implication could have been taken for the leaders of that time. Now, as I recall, he went back to Israel A. Smith.
Rode the train the next day.
That
night, actually, to talk with Israel A.
And Israel told him to go ahead and to get that, do all he could
call
to get that.
And call a press conference. Right.
And then call a press conference. And it was, as he went up there to get that copy, he could not find it. It had already been taken. Now, I believe, personally myself, that somewhere in this country there's got to be a copy of that missing copy. But we know that the Mormon Church has worked overtime to do away with these copies. There was a story that came my way many years ago about an individual who murdered by the Mormons, who had published a book involving something to do with history that they didn't know what it was about, only the fact that the books suddenly turned up missing, which I think it was like 10,000, 15,000 copies. So this has been like a number of years ago. But nonetheless, we do know that the Danite organization that apparently is believed to still be extant, and that the Mormons still do, the hierarchy of the Mormon Church still does use them. As to whether or not they're performing murders, I can't say, and I can't make that kind of statement because I don't know. But I do believe that the organism is in place and is there so that they need it, they can call upon it. It's a scary situation. Now I'm going to tell you one more story. My brother was in the military service, and he was down in El Paso, Texas, based, and this was back in 64. And he, by accident, got into a Mormon church down there. He was going to attend church, and he was not certain. He apparently didn't see all the name of the church. He saw the LDS, and for some reason it didn't register with him. I don't know why it didn't. I've wondered. I think that he was in a hurry, and he knew he was late, and he was wanting to go to church. And he was looking for our church, and he saw this, and I think he told me something about a bush or something. It was in such a way where he thought the R was obscured. And so he goes into this church, and apparently they were getting, there was kind of some confusion there where he got in and sat down, and he didn't know. He figured, well, it's a different area of the country, you know, things might be done a little differently. Come to find out, he was in a Mormon church and they had a Mormon bishop that was talking, and it was apparently, I don't think it was a business meeting, but he was laying out some proposals of what the Mormon church had in long-range planning. And part of the long range, and this is 64 now, was they were going to come back into Missouri in force. And the bishop made the statement that they were going to get the properties that they wanted one way or the other. If necessary, they were going to use all means, including force. Well, my brother said the way he stated it kind of left chills go up and down his spine, because he was indicating that in force, he interpreted that to mean murder. And of course, it was by this time that he realized where he was sitting. And he said he was very nervous. As soon as things got where he could do it, he got out of there and just backed away from that. But true to the word, they have done pretty much what my brother reported that they had planned at that time, as far as going forth and trying to buy up properties here in the areas, and they've done so. They're working overtime to acquire as much of our Missouri land here as they can.
Okay. We've got five more minutes. Is there any other questions? This is your last chance. Yes?
We were looking at property last fall up in by Far West, and the man was not he was a Christian, a Baptist, but he did not know that much about the difference between our two churches, and we told him what church we belonged to. And he said that he had been selling a lot of land around the far west area of the Mormons like crazy.
Yeah.
And that just came over me because I thought, well, what's going on? And they said, they want this land up here, especially. I was up by, I guess by Carthage, Missouri would have been where we were. Bramer.
Bramer.
The little town of Bramer. We were just a little town. I can't remember.
In the Caldwell County, around Polo.
Caldwell
Hamilton.
County was exactly yes. The county that was down. Okay. Trying to think of the little town.
Yeah, we had some experience up there. There's some hostility up there. Some years, Aaron's and I, we was going to try to find Hans Mill. We come across a group of several individuals asked for directions, and they gave us directions. And by the time we realized where we were going, we were clear out of the county. So we had to turn around and come back. But I talked with a sister that was up at the Far West Church up there, and her indication to me was that there was a lot of hostility that was starting to grow amongst what we would call the non-church population, because the Mormons were going in and they were buying property, and they were getting it any way they could get it, and it was driving up property taxes for a number of people, and then too they were being pretty snobbish about what they did and not well-mannered in the process of doing it. They were being boastful, and so to my knowledge they have purchased all of the Adam on the Amon site. If you go up there, you'll find that they've got that whole area, and they've got white fences that go into it, and it's really something else. You have to go up there to view it. But, that's going on.
Anyone else?
You mentioned the Calvinists. I think you said Calvinists that influence them, their polygamy and so forth. Have you ever heard of a group called Compromise? I read about it, and I don't know a lot about it, except that they were also influencing that.
That may have been the group. I could have made a mistake on that. The Cochranites, that sounds more like what it was.
I was just curious if there were...
I'm very glad you caught me up on that, because I think it was the Cochranites, not the Calvinites. It would be the Cochranites, because that was in New York. You see, a lot of the polygamy situation, that was very common through Frontier America, for frontiersmen to go out and they would have one wife over here, and then they'd go out with an Indian princess over here, and then they'd have another wife over here. And there was a lot of that was going on. But there was a number of free love societies that grew up at that time. Free love meaning that they shared partners, things of that nature. And cold as the hills, because when the early Protestant reform movement occurred in Europe, there was a large group of people that entertained and got involved in that sort of thing. And that's just where my mind got mixed up, because there was certain of those that was termed Calvinites who was involved in polygamy. And so this predates even a lot of the things that occurred. This before our nation was founded. So that's as old as the hills. It's one of the oldest tools the devil has to destroy man and destroy his church.
Thank you very much. Okay.